You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network. For more quality options programs, visit www.theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app, available in iTunes and on Google Play. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at twitter.com/options, facebook.com/theoptionsinsider, or via questions@theoptionsinsider.com.
Welcome to the Options Playbook, the program where we break down cutting-edge option strategies and explain how you can incorporate them into your own portfolio. Whether you're looking to grow your capital with some offensive maneuvers or protect your investments with defensive plays, you can find them all in the Options Playbook. The Options Playbook is brought to you by TradeKing Group. Anything mentioned today is for educational purposes and is not a recommendation or advice. Options involve risk. Please refer to TradeKing.com/ODD to review additional risks involved with trading options. Securities offered through TradeKing LLC, member FINRA and SIPC. Now, let's open the playbook and get started.
Welcome to Options Playbook Radio. I'm your host, Brian Overby, TradeKing Senior Options Analyst and author of The Options Playbook. If you have the Options Playbook on your table and you'd like to follow along today, please turn to page 40 in the hardback version. Or if you have access to a computer, you can always just go to optionsplaybook.com and look under the Strategies tab. In there, you'll see all the strategies. The one you want to click on today is the long call strategy. And if you have the Kindle version of the Options Playbook, you can just look for the long call strategy in the table of contents. All right, well, let's get started with Options Playbook Radio. Last week, we kind of had a major event, so we kind of went off the reservation, if you will. By now, you probably know that Apple had a 7-for-1 stock split. So we talked about what that meant to people that held options and what that was going to mean to people that were going to buy options going forward or sell options going forward. And we got into a lot of that details and even looked at a specific strategy that someone might use around a stock split. Now, today we're going to get back and focus on plays that are inside the options playbook. And today is what a lot of people would consider one of the more basic plays. It's actually play number one in the options playbook list of plays. It is called the long call. Now, as far as the long call is concerned, a lot of beginning option traders at one point in time in the life of their investing have bought stocks before. And the long call kind of fits into the pattern of buying stocks. Your whole goal with buying stocks is usually you're going to buy the stock low and hope to sell the stock high if it goes up. And by buying long calls, a lot of time you're hoping the same thing too. You're going to pay a little for the option contract. The stock is going to go up and you're going to sell it for a lot. And that's the goal of it. Now, this makes it hard for beginning option traders because if you're going to trade options, they are priced much differently than trading stocks. So there's this little nuance in the option trading world that not only do you have to be right about the direction of the underlying, it's also important to be right about the timing. And then you have little things like implied volatility. And we've talked about, we've set a base in Options Playbook Radio to start talking about these plays because we've already talked about those concepts. And I think that that's a big mistake that a lot of instructors make in the options world is they just start talking about strategies without looking at pricing. So today we're going to put pricing inside our conversation. So let's go and look at an example. And we're going to talk about the risks and rewards of buying a long call. And then we're going to look at buying in, at, and out of the money options and specific factors that we need to look for in each and every one of those cases. So before I start, though, I always like to ask the listeners questions while we're doing Options Playbook Radio. And my question today is, do you think that buying a long call is more risky or less risky than buying the stock outright? Let me ask that again. Do you think that buying a long call is more risky or less risky than buying a stock outright? The odds are that there are a lot of listeners out there that have at least purchased a call in at one time in their investing career. And I'm always curious as to what your thought is to that question. How I would answer it is it depends. And what I mean is it really depends on how you're treating the leverage that's inside an option contract. So today, let's go through a generic example. Once again, we'll call it on stock XYZ. Let's say that we have a $50 stock with a $50 strike. Okay, so we're going to talk about an at-the-money option to start with. We're going to go out 90 days in time, and I'm actually using the Trade King options pricing calculator to come up with some of these numbers. And I just want to make it a generic example. And let's say that it's trading at about a 20% implied volatility, and interest rates are fairly low where they are right now in the marketplace. And if we look at that and we throw that into a calculator, basically that says that this option contract should be trading for about $2. So now let's go through a scenario, and let's say if you were to go out and buy that stock and you buy 100 shares of that stock, how much would that cost you? Well, it would cost you the current price of the stock, which is 50 times 100 or $5,000. And you have to add on a commission on that. Don't always remember to add on to the commission, but it's approximately $5,000 to buy 100 shares of stock. Now let's go on out and look at that option contract. If that option contract is trading for $2, you're looking at a 90-day option. Stock is 50, strike is 50, and implied volatility is around 20%. And we look at that and we say, well, that's $2. Most option contracts represent 100 shares. So that would cost $2 times 100 or $200 plus commission to do that trade. So if I take the approach in the options world that I normally buy 100 shares of stock, so I'm going to buy one contract that represents 100 shares of stock, I could make the argument that by buying this one option contract, I'm actually limiting my risk. I'm not increasing risk. And that if I buy this option contract, my maximum loss is going to be the debit paid plus that commission, or approximately $200. My max gain is unlimited on the upside. All the break-even point is going to be the strike price plus the premium paid, or $52 here. But on the downside, if the stock goes down, I don't have to worry about losing any more than that premium paid. Now, if I bought the stock outright, I have $5,000 worth of risk. And if the stock goes down, I can lose in concept that entire $5,000. Now, that would not happen that often in the world, but it does happen from time to time that stocks actually do go bankrupt or companies go bankrupt. So if you take the leverage factor out of it and you use options to just participate in the stock price movement without all the risk, you can make an argument that buying a long call option is a less risky venture than buying the stock outright. Now, what do most people do? Well, they think to themselves, well, gee, I have $5,000. I was going to go out and spend that $5,000 to buy 100 shares of stock. And instead, I'm going to go out and buy options. So now how many options can I buy with my $5,000? And I do the math and I come up with 25 contracts. So don't forget my commission to add it all in there. Bottom line is now I'm using options to leverage my account, and now I could lose my entire investment much easier than if I had just bought the stock outright. So this is a big factor. And if you're a beginning option trader, this is important to note. And we actually cover this in the rookies corner of the options playbook. It's actually on page 28 inside the rookies corner. And you can just look for it talking about the leverage factor of options online and in the Kindle version. But bottom line is there's got to be a happy medium. I think if you're just starting with options and you normally buy 100 shares of stock, you should really think about just buying one option contract until you get used to how options move. If you buy 200 shares, buy two contracts, et cetera, that's just a simple place to start. Now, once you get the leverage factor down and you decide how many contracts that you want to buy, now we have to go through a scenario and talk about, well, which option contract do I want to buy? And we did mention that if you buy an at-the-money option contract in this scenario, your max risk is that $200, but you have substantial upside potential. Now, to get down to the strike prices, we have to talk about other things that we highlight inside the options playbook. You have to think a lot about what happens to my option contract as time goes by. There's a time component in most option contracts that you need to think about. And also other things that we've already brought up in the beginning sessions of Options Playbook Radio. One other thing is implied volatility. Once you establish this play and you have this position on, what would you like to happen to implied volatility? And in order to do that, though, once you kind of get a grasp of these things, then we can start to think about, well, what option contract would I like to buy? Do I want to buy an in-the-money option contract, an at-the-money option contract, or an out-of-the-money option contract? And to answer these questions, you need to know about the time premium that's involved in that option contract. Now, if we're talking about our first scenario where we just have an at-the-money option contract, the stock is 50, strike was 50, we went out 90 days, implied volatility was 20%, and we came up with a $2 option contract. Now, that option contract is all time value. And if you look at a specific expiration, today we're just going to talk about a 90-day expiration. If you look at that specific expiration, the bulk of the time premium is always centered around the most at-the-money option contract. And in this instance, it's all time. Paying $2 worth of time premium for that option contract. Now, if we go further out of the money, and let's say we look at a 55 strike call option here, that option is obviously going to trade for less. The right to buy the stock at 50, a lower price, is going to cost you more than the right to buy the stock at 55. That's fairly obvious in the options world. So I did the math on it, threw it in the options pricing calculator, and came up with a price of about 45 cents. All right. So now that is definitely all-time premium because we're out of the money. The stock is at 50. We have the right to buy it at 55. Right now, that option contract, it doesn't make any sense to do that. That means it's considered an out-of-the-money option contract. Why would we buy the stock at 55 when it's trading at 50? So time premium went down because overall cost went down when we're talking about the right to buy the stock at 55 versus 50. Now, if we go down and we look a little bit in the money, we look at the 45 strike call option, a lot of beginning investors struggle with why would I ever want to buy an in-the-money option contract? Well, one thing that's true about the deeper and deeper you get in the money, the more and more the option contract will be made up of real value or referred to as intrinsic value. The 45 strike call, if I threw it in the options calculator, is trading for $5.35. All right. But five of that is real value because the stock is at 50 right now. I could exercise my right, buy it at 45, go out on the real marketplace and sell it at 50. Hence, it's 5 points in the money. But it also that time component is in there, but it's a very small percentage of the total price. That additional 35 cents, we got 5 points of intrinsic value and 35 cents worth of time value. So now if you're looking at all of these option contracts, there are different things that you have to think about. And let's start with the at-the-money option contract. This is sometimes the trickiest contract to have to trade, mainly because there is so much time premium in it. And when we're looking at this in this scenario today, it's important to note that we're just going to talk about buying one contract. And we're going to look at the good things and the bad things of buying one in the money contract, one at the money contract, and one out of the money contract. And if we're buying an at the money contract, we are getting a lot of leverage. It's not the cheapest of the option contracts, but it's not the most expensive. But we are paying for a ton of time value. So time decay is the biggest issue on at-the-money options. And we went over this in great detail in the beginning of Options Playbook Radio. And we talked about how options decay at an accelerated rate as expiration approaches. So we have to manage time decay if we're buying at-the-money option contracts. We need to have a forecast as to where we how much we think the underlying is going to move and how fast we think it's going to move. In other words, you need a forecast on a direction and on the timing. And if the stock hasn't made the move by this specific date that you have in your forecast, you should get out of that underlying. And another thing that's involved with options that have a lot of time premium is volatility. Volatility is a bigger component of at-the-money option contracts than a lot of other option contracts in that same expiration, mainly because there is a lot of time premium in that option contract. So the implied volatility number that's in that contract can be fairly large relative to other option contracts in that same expiration. So the vega, which is the Greek that tracks volatility, has a tendency to be the largest number on at-the-money option contracts. So these are important factors that you need to think about when you're buying an at-the-money option contract. So what might have a tendency to steer me away from this at-the-money option contract? Well, if I have big news events, if you're trading just a volatile stock in general, at-the-money option contracts add a big – that implied volatility component that's in it is a big challenge for trading those in-the-money options. So let's say we have a major earning event, and because of that, implied volatilities have risen quite a bit heading up into earnings. You want to make a play because you think earnings are going to be good. Good. So you buy that at the money option contract. Now, that price might be inflated because when you're buying at the money option contracts, it's easy to see that earnings in an insurance scenario is kind of like a hurricane coming at your house in Florida, right? At that point in time that hurricane siren is ringing, it's very hard to get your hands around an insurance contract. And in the options world, when you're buying that call option, that earnings report can be a major event and really move the stock price. So you're paying up, you're paying a premium, and that premium is called implied volatility. Now, if I'm still talking about one contract, a lot of people would say, well, why would you ever want to buy an out-of-the-money option contract? Well, if I buy that one out of the money option contract, I just don't have as much at risk, right? Because it's a cheaper option. But I still have issues because I'm still buying all time premium if I'm buying an out of the money option, but I'm not spending quite as much. So if we're just talking about one contract, well, yeah, I am not spending as much and have as much at risk, but I need the underlying stock to move more. And in Options Playbook Episode 3, we talked a lot about buying out-of-the-money option contracts and that scenario. Now, with that same scenario, if I look at an in-the-money option contract, well, yeah, I'm paying more for it. So here I have most of my risk is relative to the price. So in our scenario, we had a 45 strike call option. It was trading for $5.35. So I'm risking quite a bit more on this one trade, but I take that time component and I make it a much smaller percentage of the price. So on the at-the-money, it was 100% of the price. The out-of-the-money, 100% of the price. The in-the-money now, there was 35 cents, which is only about 7% of the price. So time decay isn't as big of a factor on a percentage of price. And implied volatility what happens with it is a much smaller factor as far as the price. So a lot of people will shy away from buying in the money option contracts, but now you're just really focused on the movement of the underlying stock. And yes, you have more risk in that you've paid more for that option contract, but you're getting a lot of intrinsic value to go along with it, right? So since in this scenario, that option is worth $5 intrinsically. Okay. So around a major news event where you're worried about these things, one of the things if you're buying option contracts is maybe go to look at a more in-the-money option contract. And one of the good things that goes along with this, and we've already talked about this, is delta. If I'm buying a more in-the-money option contract, it will act more like the stock. It will represent the stock price movement more. And in this scenario, the 45 strike call option would be about 86 or 86 cents. That means that if the stock goes up one, that option contract should go up about 86 cents. So I'm getting, for my dollars, I'm getting good representation of the stock price movement, and I'm reducing my risk to the unknown factor and what's going to happen to that time premium. And I'm reducing it a lot. So I'm getting good stock price movement, and I'm not as worried about time decay and what might happen to implied volatility. An at-the-money option contract in this scenario, that would have a delta of around 52 in this instance. All right. So I do get fairly decent stock representation, but I have a lot of issues dealing with time decay and what might happen to the implied volatility. And the last option contract, the 55 strike, had a delta of about 18. All right. So we talked about an earnings scenario and kind of leading towards the in-the-money option contract and the out-of-the-money option contract. Now, remember, we're just talking about buying one contract. So when might I want to look at a more out-of-the-money option contract? When might that be a better scenario? Well, if I have a big forecast, whenever you're looking at out-of-the-money option contracts, you really need to think that that stock's got to go through the strike, not just make the strike by that expiration. And I would say that it needs to go 1 or 2 points at least beyond that strike. Now, depending on the underlying, but in this scenario, I'd want to see, have a forecast that I think that stock can get to 56 or 57 if I'm looking to buy that option contract. And I want to do it in times when the markets are more normal in that there's no major news events, nothing that's going on, but I'm looking for this thing to make a move. And I always have a tendency to even say, maybe I might do it a little bit further out in time. If I'm looking at longer term options, I might have a tendency to buy a more out of the money option contract to give that time to get there. But always remember that it really needs to get there. And we talked about the scenario, and I can actually throw this into the options pricing calculator, and we walk through this. But if we have this 90-day option, and let's just say there's no major news events, we just like the underlying, we think it can move. If we got a stock at 50 and a strike is 50, over 90 days to get to 55, a lot of people don't think, well, gee, that's a 10% move in 90 days on that stock. That's a very big move. That's why that option is trading for what it is. And if you go out and you look at that option, and let's say it makes half the move in half the time, let's say it goes to 52.50, halfway to the strike, and it takes 45 days to get there. Would you be up on that option contract? Would you have a profit, or would you have a loss, or would you be flat? In general, you'd probably be closer to flat. Taking out all the other factors that could happen in the options world, and we'll just talk about price and time, a lot of times in that scenario, the probability of it actually getting to that strike hasn't changed, so the price should be just about where it was when it started. And that's the hardest thing for beginning option traders to comprehend. That it's possible to buy an out-of-the-money option contract, be right on your forecast, and not be profitable in your strategy. Now, the at-the-money option contract, if you're not as worried about time decay, if you're looking at, let's say, a swing trader, I'm only going to be in it for a couple of days, or maybe even a week at a time, where I'm managing that time decay – a lot of times that at the money option contract is a good solid strategy to buy. And you see this in the options world because most of the volume in open interest is centered around that at the money option contract. So when I'm thinking about at the money option contracts here, I'm kind of thinking that I might be a little bit closer to expiration. I have a shorter term forecast. I'm looking for a move quickly in the underlying. And if that is that type of scenario, that's when a lot of people will gravitate to at the money option contracts. So what's the moral to the story? If I'm looking at buying, and these, and by the way, there's no golden book of answers when it comes to buying in at or out of the money option contracts. Not by any means. You tell me where that stock's going to end up at expiration, I can give you the best contract that you want to buy. But without that knowledge going into it, there are certain times when you want to look at certain option strikes and expirations. If I'm trading around in earnings and I really want to buy a call because I think the stock's going to go up after earnings, very rarely would I buy an at the money or out of the money. I don't want to deal with that implied volatility component and that risk to time decay. If I'm looking at buying, I'm looking at a shorter term move, maybe doing technical analysis on a specific stock, and I'm looking to hold it for a couple of days. At the money option contracts are a very explosive option contract. They have fairly decent delta, and that delta will move quickly when that option gets in the money. And you're, by the way, it's right at the money. It doesn't take much to make it an in the money contract. And those option contracts, a lot of people have a tendency to gravitate towards if they're doing some short time of either day trading or swing trading. Out of the money option contracts, those will usually work better if you're looking to buy when you have sometimes even a longer term forecast where you think the stock's going to take a while to get to that price. Or if you're looking at it, and obviously you want that leverage. If you're looking for a very big move in the underlying, you really think that it can make that type of move, then the out-of-the-money contract gives you a lot of leverage, and you're going to get more bang for your buck if you are correct on your forecast. All right, well, that's it for this episode of Options Playbook Radio. Next time, we're going to continue discussion on long calls, but now we're going to just emphasize on leap options, and we're going to stick in this realm, but we're going to talk about buying a leap, which just stands for long-term equity anticipation security. It's an acronym that was designed by the Chicago Board Option Exchange, but bottom line is it just means longer-term options going out over 9 months in time, and we're going to talk about buying leaps as a surrogate to buying stocks or buying in the money leaps to be more specific. So we're going to take this concept and we're going to look at actually buying options as a stock substitute. All right. If you have a topic you'd like to discuss on the show or a question you'd like answered on the program, we now have a Facebook page that you can go to. Just go to the Trade King Facebook page, and there's a little tab that will take you to Options Playbook Radio. It's facebook.com/TradeKing if you want to go there directly. Or you can always just send questions to questions@theoptionsinsider.com. And as always, you can always connect with me via the Trade King Trader Network and my blog. It's called the Options Guy blog. Thanks for listening, and we'll be back at the same time and same place next week. Until then, may all the options you bought finish in the money and all the ones you sold finish out.
The Options Playbook was brought to you by Trade King Group. Anything mentioned today is for educational purposes and is not a recommendation or advice. Options involve risk. Please refer to TradeKing.com/ODD to review additional risks involved with trading options. Securities offered through TradeKing LLC, member FINRA and SIPC.
The preceding program was a production of the Options Insider Radio Network. For more quality options programs, visit www.theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app, available in iTunes and on Google Play. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at twitter.com/options, facebook.com/the the Options Insider or via questions at theoptionsinsider.com. At W.